Mister
Usman, Usman.
Oh ya, Usman. Please, Usman. Okay.
To distinguish between text and non-text, I think a text is a group of sentences, a group of sentences which has meaningful, which has meaning.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, just simple simple definition. Thank
okay.
You.
Get the point. Okay. Next.
Mister, you tante, sir.
You tante, okay.
Yes. I think text is kind of group of words or sentences, mm-hmm. which is has meaning. Which is not text. It is meaningless. It group can be in word. A word or sentences, mm-hmm. and it is, can be in a form of written and also in a spoken.
Okay. I get the point. Written and spoken. Good.
I'm.
Okay. Next, Rizky.
I'm. Okay. Yes. I think the text is definition from words, sentences, written in the book, and that the author feel the reader, and then non-text like a diagram, chart, map, caption, and the others not written in the book.
Okay, I got the point. Okay, next.
Me, sir. Are you?
Are you? Okay.
Yeah. Yes. I think the difference between text and non-text is in terms of the generic structure. So okay. Text has generic structure, while non-text doesn't have generic structure. Text has the topic of the text has been identified, but non-text not yet identified.
Yeah, I get the point. Generic structure. Okay, next, number six. Enough?
Bisa, Nani ya. Fatima.
Ya, Fatima. Nani ya?
Yes, sir. Text, just like a recount text, narrative text, it is a group of sentence in generic structure. But non-text is just like a graphic or diagram, map. That's non-text. I think that's it. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Number seven.
Is it me? Please?
Yeah.
Is it me?
Yeah, Mr.
Okay. In my opinion.
Okay, your name, your name.
Ali Mutakin.
Yeah, Ali. Yeah. Okay.
My opinion. Thanks. Okay. A material that is presented in a piece of paper that can be read by the students. It can be material and also it can be a kind of a text, written text. While non-text is a material, but it is not presented in a written form, but it is presented in oral form. It can be a materials also, but it can be also such kind of a spoken text like this one.
Oh yes, okay. Spoken, yeah.
Excuse me, sir. May I add?
Yeah. You? Your name?
Yeah. According to me, it is the text. It can be in a form of picture.
Tidak kan?
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. A picture. Your name, yeah. Your name.
Yutantin.
Yeah, okay. Yutantin.
It can be in a form of picture or diagram or sign. Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Yeah. A text, it can be in the form of picture, diagram, or sign. It belongs to?
Yeah.
Yeah, belongs to text. Okay. Any other? Number nine. Enough?
Enough.
Okay, thank you. Now, for 5 minutes, please mute your... Okay, yeah. mute your speaker ya.
Okay.
Yeah, for about 5 minutes. Later, if I ask question, you unmute again. Okay, please mute all of you. Okay, number one, what is the difference between text and non-text? Yeah. I get the point from Usman. Yeah. If it is meaningful, it is a text. Yeah. Okay. From Usman. Yeah. The key point is meaningful. If it is not meaningful, it has no meaning. It is not text. Yeah. It can be word, sentence, or paragraph. If it has no meaning, it is not a text. And the point of text is meaning or meaningful. Yeah. Like what Yutanti said. Yeah. Written or spoken. Yeah. So you have to understand well about this because text is not only written, but what is spoken is also text, as long as it has meaning. Okay, text. And then who else? Picture, yeah, Yutantin. Picture, sign, word, as long as it has meaning, it is a kind of text. Okay. Now the first point is we have to differentiate between text and non-text. The keyword is meaning or meaningful. If it is meaningful, it is a text. But if it is not meaningful, it is not a text or non-text. Okay. Now we continue to the next point. Yeah. Number two, what are the benefits of teaching genres to the students? Apa manfaatnya kita mengajarkan genre ini kepada siswa? Ya. Okay. Now please unmute your speaker if you want to answer question number two. Okay. Who first?
Me, sir.
Okay. You.
Yes. What are the benefits of teaching genres to the students? It helps the students to understand about the main idea of the text.
Okay.
And the purpose of the text.
Your name. Yeah, I don't see you.
My name is Ayu.
Okay. Ayu. Okay, the keyword is
understand the main idea and the topic of the text.
Okay. The main idea.
Help the students to understand. But
okay, you and then you mute again, yeah, and then the next.
Yes, sir.
First. Okay.
Okay. What is the benefits of teaching the genres to the student? I think when we share many knowledge about the genres, many kinds of genres, so students can communicate and well educated and also well attitude to be a citizen, so they will have a good communication in their daily life. I think that is
okay. One more, yeah. Kita see you mute again. Next.
Me.
Rizky. Okay.
Right. Number one, how to student learn from what and
Number one. Help. Okay. The others, you can mute your speaker, yeah. Okay. Only the speaker unmute, yeah. Okay. Yeah, continue.
Number one, help student learn from what they read. Number two, student know that the text is great and a student can easily learn from the new information. And
next. Yeah, continue. Okay, number four, continue.
Yes, sir.
Ada
apa? Yes, sir. Hello.
Hello, who is
yes, this? Sir.
May I continue?
Mr. first. Mr.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Usman.
Usman again. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think the benefit of teaching genders to students, one of them is about understanding the purposes of the text, because each text has their own purposes, such as announcement. The purpose of announcement is to give information. The purpose of narrative story is to tell or to entertain the readers and to give moral value, to teach moral value to the readers. So, yeah, understanding the genders helps students to know the purposes of the writer, what actually the readers want us to do or to understand.
Okay, okay, continue.
Emma.
Emma.
Yeah. Okay. According to my opinion, the benefits of teaching genres to our student is make our student become an active readers.
Active readers. Yeah. Okay.
Whatever, what kind of text that they will have to read, they forced to be an active reader. I think that's all. Thank you.
Okay.
Sir, yeah? I want to eat.
Okay, hello. Please. Yeah, hello. Yeah.
Me, Husna.
Yeah, Husna. Okay.
Okay. The question is, what are the benefits of teaching genders to the students? I think the first, when we give the material genders to the student, we can build the skill building for students, especially in reading. So we can improve their skill in reading, the first, and then we can add their vocabulary. We can add their vocabulary if we keep any material, any kind of genres, and we can, for example, we bring a narrative text like a story, legend, etc. Maybe it will bring the fun too. It will bring the fun too.
Okay.
Okay, I think that's enough for me. Maybe the other can add it. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. I think that's all, yeah, for this slide, yeah. Okay, mm-hmm. you can for the next session, yeah. Please mute, yep, again. Okay. Mute, yep, again. Yours.
Okay.
Now.
Dibatasi kah?
Later, we still have time, yeah. Still have time. What are the benefits of teaching genres to students, yeah? The benefits mean after students mastering the genres, mastering the function, okay, mastering the generic structure, etc. Actually, the main benefit is to make student well educated, yeah, like what Yutantin said, yeah, what Yutan stated, yeah, Yutantin get the best point, yeah, for point number two, to make students able to communicate and to be well educated, because yeah, genre like recount text, narrative text, yeah, discussion are not only taught in Indonesia, but also they are taught in American, in English. Actually, English people can speak English well. Yeah, American people can speak English well. So the main purpose is to make students well educated. Yeah, to make people polite, yeah, to other people, how to communicate well. So it is the main objective, the main benefits of teaching genres, not only the language, yeah, but how to use the language and their real life. Okay, that is point number two. Hello. Okay, we continue to the next point, yeah. Okay. Nah, this is the answer. Text is a single word or combination of words. Yeah. So text is can be a single word. Text not always in the form of sentences, in the form of paragraph, or in the form of long text, but a single word can be text. Yeah. Letter can be a text as long as it has meaning. Yeah. Okay. The keyword contains meaning logically and structure. And how about non-text? Non-text is a letter, word, combination of words, or a paragraph that is not meaningful. Yeah. It is a paragraph, but it has no meaning. The paragraph has no meaning. So the paragraph is not a text because the paragraph has no meaning. Yeah. One word, but one word or one letter, it has meaning. It is a text. Yeah. Okay. Later I give you the references. Okay, next. Nah, this is the benefit of teaching genre. Yeah. After mastering the language, after mastering the genre of the genre, the students will become an educated and civilized citizen. Yeah, educated and civilized citizen. Children need to learn to communicate regularly. Yeah, actually, this is the end of our objective, our goal of teaching English. Yeah, to make them educated, to make them civilized. Yeah, and make them able to communicate regularly. Okay. Now, we discuss the next point. In text, students need to know phrase, close sentence. Now, please unmute your speaker. Yeah. Okay. Who first? Mention your name.
Yeah. Ali. Ali.
Ali. Okay. Ali.
Please let me answer. Phrase is a group of words that has one meaning. Clause is a group of words, but this is not a sentence or not a complete sentence because it needs another part of words that can complete the sentence. So clause is a combination of words. It consists of subject and predicate, but it doesn't. It is not called as a sentence. So, yeah. Well, sentence is this is a complete information because it is it consists of subject, verb, or other part of sentence, and it doesn't need any addition of word or phrase because it has already complete as a sentence.
Okay, good. Ali, yeah, continue. Next, want to say something about phrase, clause, and sentence? Okay, enough. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Enough. Yeah.
Me.
Okay. I'll try, sir.
Okay. Your name?
Yutantin.
Yutantin.
Okay. Yeah. Sentence. Mm-hmm. It's a group of words which can stand by itself and it has meaning. Well, clause. Mm-hmm. It's the unity of words, mm-hmm. which is giving delivering the message.
Message.
And it can it consists of subject, verb. Subject and verb.
Yeah.
Without object. Is it right, sir? Without object.
Okay.
Which is the phrase.
Subject. Subject verb. It can be subject verb and a noun verb and noun. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Without object, right, sir?
Okay. Some of the sentence. I want to know your opinion. Okay. Some of the sentence.
And then the phrase. It is a group of words. Which is. Has a function. But there is no verb. There is no verb.
Verb.
Okay, so I think enough.
Okay.
Who is singing?
Who is singing? Okay. Please mute, yeah. Okay. Mute the song. Okay. Any other?
Nisa.
Nisa.
Fenty.
Okay.
Fenty.
Okay.
Fenty, yes.
Yeah.
Phrase is, I think, a group of words that stand together as a single grammatical unit. Okay. Clause consists of subject and verb. And sentence, actually sentence has the complete one. Example, there are subject, verb, object, and etc. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. In depth, yeah, for yeah. Okay, please. Yeah, you can give your comments after this. Yeah. Okay. Press. A group of words. Yeah, it can be. A group of words. It can be noun and noun, adjective and noun. Etc. Yeah, press and close. The point we got from Ali, yeah, Ali's explanation very complete about the difference between press, close, and sentences. Yeah, in presses only a group of words, yeah, but in close a group of words, but it has noun and verb. But the clause must be completed by other word. But in sentence, noun, verb, and we can understand the expression without additional word. That is the sentence. Yeah. The next question is, how do we teach students? How do we teach students to make them understand the difference between press, clause, and sentence? Okay. How do we teach students about presses, clauses, and sentences based on your best experience? Yeah. Okay. Now, please unmute your speaker.
Me first.
Yeah.
Me first.
Ali. Usman.
Okay. For me.
Ali apa?
For me to teach the student the difference between those three terms, I can give an example that.
Example.
An example of sentence that consists of those things, consists of phrase, clause, and also sentence. Okay. So the sentence is consists of clauses and also consists of phrases.
Okay, very good. Okay, it's clear. The next.
Okay.
Rizky, sir.
Oh, Rizky, yeah.
Please. I give three sentences about phrase, a clause, and and then for the three sentences, student identifying what is the phrase, what is the flow, and what is the sentences.
Okay, identifying. Okay. The process of identifying means you use metacognitive, yeah, just Anderson. If you ask students to make analyze, yeah, and the indicator of analysis is the students have to know, have to differentiate between press and close, yeah.
Press and close.
In order to be able to differentiate, the students have to analyze. Yeah, it is a kind of hot activity. Okay, very good. Yeah. You ask students to analyze. That is the point.
Identifying. Yeah.
Okay, by identifying first. Yeah, maybe mentioning, identifying, kemudian differentiating. It is a kind of the process of metacognitive from Anderson taxonomy. Okay. Please, the other.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. How do you teach?
Yeah. The way I teach the students to distinguish between phrases, sentences, clauses, and sentences. I teach from the small one. I mean, I start from phrases, and the examples also. Noun phrase, verb phrase, or adverb phrase. Then move to the next, which longer one is close. And after that, I teach sentences. So I start from the small thing. Then after having taught those three things, then I give an example which consists of in a sentence consists of the phrase I start, for example, when I teach a walking stick, then I use the phrase is walking stick in a sentence. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, sir, thank you.
Okay.
Okay, before I teach them about phrase, clause, and sentence, the students have to know what is subject verb, adjective, where is adverb, and etc. And then after that, we will continue with phrase. Okay, and then after they know about phrase, we can continue again with clause, and the last one is sentence. So some of the students do not understand. Yeah, sorry, do not know where is what is adjective, what is adverb, and noun. So from the beginning, sir. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, Fenty, if you use like this, it means that you use a deductive theory, yeah, because you present it first and then the students practice, yeah. Presentation, practice, presentation. Yeah, it is a kind of deductive. But in taxonomy Anderson, we have to change our way of teaching by using analyzing. Yeah, the students need to analyze. So it is better if the students can find the theory, the concept by themselves. So the teachers only give facility or activities to make students understand, yeah, make them find by their own concept, yeah. We just only give them activities, but if you still use from the definition first, the concept first, and then practice example, it is a good teaching, but a good teaching, but not improve the students' thinking skill. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Got it. Thank you.
Okay. Now we continue to the next. Yeah. Like this. You set subject, predicate, object, direct object, or complement. or it can be a sentence at least consists of subject and predicate. Okay. Now we continue to the next topic. I hope the participants who have not given opinion about this topic, please give comments. Yeah. So the others, please give a chance to our friends. Our friends who have not stated or not given an opinion about our topic. Okay, who wants to give comments, please unmute your, maybe you can say about simple sentence, compound sentence, and complex sentence. Okay, who first?
Me, sir.
You? Your Aisa. Name?
Aisa, Aisa, sir.
Okay, very yes. Good, Aisa. Okay.
I think a simple sentence is a sentence that only has one clause, I think. Mm-hmm. One clause. It is, in Indonesia, for example, we call this kalimat tunggal. Mm-hmm. I think that's my opinion.
Okay, simple sentence, yeah. Mm-hmm. Next.
Yes, sir. Maybe the other.
Yeah, the other.
Continue.
Okay.
Me.
Okay.
Let me answer about simple sentence. Simple sentence is a sentence that only consists of subject and predicates. It doesn't have any other complement like object, adverb of time, etc.
Mm-hmm.
That's all. Complex sentence is, it's a long sentence that has clauses. Mm-hmm. And it also has more than subject and predicate, of course.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not sure about the compound sentence. Sorry.
Okay. Please, the others can add.
Mister, Nani Fatima.
Okay. Nani.
Yeah. I think simple sentence just consists of subject, predicate, and also the complement. So it is one sentence only. It can be just like a simple sentence like that. And then, but about compound sentence, it consists of dependent clause and independent clause, I think. Mm. So it can be two sentence, I think, just that. But two clauses, I think. So there is a dependent clause and independent clause. And then the complex sentence, it can be two sentences, just like when I go to Bali or just like that, and then there is another sentence that different with the first sentence. When I go to Bali, my friend do something, just like that. I think that's all. Thank you very much.
Okay, very good. Compound sentence. Two sentences become
simple sentence.
Become two simple sentences become combined become compound sentences. Yeah. For example, my husband is, you know, my husband is very good. My husband is very kind. But he is lazy. two simple sentences become one sentence using, you know, what do you say? But and or, what do you say? And
conjunction,
yeah, compound sentence. Okay, and then conjunction, yeah, and you can use. However, yeah, it is a kind of conjunction. And complex sentence you can cross it in our materials format, essential materials in the form of PDF, ya. Material 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, ya. Until 9.
Finish, you have finish to, download.
You have to read it all, ya. Okay. Now,
thank you.
Paragraph. Okay, paragraph. This is now we try to practice number one.
What is the compound sentence then?
Okay,
I missed the point.
Compound sentence, two simple sentences combined become one sentence using
connection. Conjunction. Okay, thank you.
Conjunction. And then complex sentence, one simple sentence plus compound sentence, become one sentence. Become complex sentence. Now, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, you can get more explanation in module 1, with the point of PDF. Okay. Who wants to answer? Number 1. Is it simple? Is it compound or complex?
Simple.
Okay. Simple. Okay. What is the subject?
The training is
college athletes. Okay, good. The training rooms of this college athletes is subject. Predicate.
No. I think there is something wrong with number one.
Oh. Yeah. Okay. What's wrong?
The predicate is smell.
Yeah. Good.
Smell. Yeah.
Smell.
It's a verb.
Linking verb. Okay. Linking verb. Okay.
Aggressive.
Smell linking verb. So simple. Sentences. The training rules of this college student is a subject.
Smell predicted.
Smell of
okay.
Number 2.
Compound.
How do you know? Two sentences. The first sentence. Their practice field is a stretch of a
spiral.
Conjunction.
Yeah, usually. There is comma before conjunction.
Yes.
Don't forget to put comma before conjunction.
The tool are speaking complex sentence. That is complex sentence. That is sentence because.
If it is a compound sentence, it must be two subject.
There
how many subjects are there?
The two subjects.
Which one?
Compound sentence.
There are subjects, there are two and basketball.
There are two are.
Spanner.
Which one is
conjunction?
Conjunction.
Rather than.
Sedang.
No. Yeah. If it is a compound sentence, it must be a subject after conjunction. Number three belongs to
compound sentence.
Number four.
Number four.
Simple sentence. Because it only has subject and predicate.
You ran a college at least.
I think one subject and one predicate.
Because it consists of one clause.
Okay.
Because in this sentence does consist of one sentence, one clause. Okay.
How about number five?
Number five.
Compound sentence.
Most students are very majors, comma.
I think that is compound sentence because that sentence is consists of two clause.
Jelas ya. Nah, interpersonal and transactional. Okay, who want to say something about interpersonal and transactional?
Wait a moment.
Okay, ya. We continue discussing this. Interpersonal is the expression used for the sake of psychologically convenient. Interpersonal. The keyword is psychologically convenient. To make us convenient, we have to speak. To make us convenient, we have to speak. This is interpersonal. Like this.
Sorry, sir. Your audio is not good here.
Yeah. Your audio.
Okay. There are two teams.
I cannot hear your voice clearly here.
Oh yeah. Okay. Yeah. Is it clear? Yeah. Hello.
Yeah. Clear now.
Yeah.
Yes. Baik.
Memberi dan merespon sapaan. It belongs to interpersonal. Ya. Memperkenalkan diri. Terima kasih. Beri maaf. Gunakan ucapan kesantun. Interpersonal. Meminta dan memberi persetujuan, memberi respon atas pertanyaan, berperhatian terhadap pembicara, mengawali, memperpanjang dan yang berlaku sehari-hari. Lakukan dengan menanggapi keraguan, menunjukkan perhatian, merespon lingkungan kegemaran, memberi cerita yang menarik perhatian dan beri komentar terhadap kita. Oke.
Ayat-ayat.
Ya.
Di mana?
Sorry sir for interrupting, but I think some of our friends not mute their.
Iya iya.
Please explain, mute yourself please.
Nah itu bukan kata RT yang mengeluarkan, itu yang menghaminya.
You hear that? Someone is shit and chat in our sorry guys please, and mute yourself please.
Yeah, okay, is it confit now? Who is absent?
Mengetahui
ya. Ya, you can ask your group. How many of you? Yutantin, Noni Hawani.
Okay. In this meeting is 24, sir. I think.
Oh, 24. Okay.
Right now, yes. Okay. I'm here, sir. Noni Hawani. I'm here, sir.
Okay.
I am here.
Okay, now please we come to question and answer session because our topic today only until interpersonal and transactional. We discuss about genre for the next meeting. And then if we have still time, we will continue after Jumat prayer, yeah, live chatting about 1 hour, and then we will free after that, yeah. Okay, next question and answer. We still have 10 minutes.
So what is the meaning of transactional text in English?
The question from Ali Mutakin?
Yes, Usman. Yes.
Ali
yes.
Mutakin. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Transactional, please. Others answer. No?
Question, sir.
We have to answer first. We have to answer Ali Mutakin first. Yeah. Interpersonal is psychologically convenient supaya kita merasa nyaman. But transactional, the expression we want something done, yeah, or the expression we have to, because we have to speak, we have to communicate. It is a must. It is a transactional. We have some examples. Maybe the others can give example. Transactional, transaksi, transactional.
Transaksi.
We have to speak. We have to speak.
Communication.
But asking. No choice for us, yeah. Because if we want to buy something, yeah, we have to, okay, to say. If asking. We want to register, yeah. Okay, Titanti.
The example of asking and offering help, perhaps.
Yeah, okay. Asking for help. For example, we want to book in a hotel. Yeah, we have to speak. It is transactional. Yeah, the simplest example. If you want to stay in a hotel and then we speak to the receptionist, we have to register. It is a kind of transactional. And many others example. We communicate or we speak because it is we have to, but in interpersonal it is a choice. Yeah. You can speak or not. Yeah, it is not problem. Only to make you convenience. Okay, next. We still have 5 minutes. Okay, if there is no question, I think that's all for our meeting this morning. Please read the module 1 in the course of Materi Esensial Bahasa Inggris, ya. Yeah. Module 1, you have to read module 1 today and module 2 tonight until module 9. Okay.
And there I is.
Are you leaving, sir?